Hey everyone, welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, I'm Ton, and this is where we break down the latest Linux news every week. Without the hype, without the clickbait, just the facts you need to know. And what a week it's been! We've got some genuinely exciting stuff to talk about today. Fedora 43 just dropped with a controversial decision that's going to affect a lot of users. Linux gaming just hit a milestone that we've been waiting years to see, and System 76 finally gave us a date for the Cosmic Desktop. So grab your coffee, settle in, and let's dive into what happened in the Linux world this past week. Alright, let's start with the foundation of everything we do, the Linux kernel. We're currently in development for Linux 6.18, and this week we released Release Candidate 4. Now, Linus Torvalds had some reassuring words in the RC4 announcement. He said, and I quote, "None of it looks particularly scary," which, if you've been following kernel development for any length of time, you know that's precisely what you want to hear at this stage of the release cycle. So what's actually in 6-18 RC4? Well, we've got a collection of minor graphics driver fixes. Nothing major, just the usual polish you'd expect at this stage. Some new AMD Zen 6 model IDs are being added, indicating the kernel is preparing to support AMD's next generation processors. And speaking of AMD, there's a fix for the Zen 5 RDSEED handling issue that was discovered a few weeks back. For those who don't know, RDSEED is a CPU instruction that generates random numbers. It's used for cryptography and security. An architectural issue was found in how AMD's Zen 5 processors handle RDSEED, and the implemented fix actually disables RDSEED entirely on all Zen 5 CPUs. That's a pretty significant workaround, but it's necessary to prevent potential security issues. Oh man, the Linux 6.18 timeline looks good. We're on track for a stable release either at the end of November or in the first week of December. However, Linus mentioned that the holiday season could delay Linux 6.19, which would be the next development cycle. We also saw some stable kernel updates this week. Versions 6.17.7, 6.12.57, and 6.6.116 all included essential fixes. If you're running any of these kernel versions, you'll want to update soon. Now, here's something interesting that came out of left field. There's a brand new NTFS driver for Linux called NTFSPLUS. And before you say, wait, don't we already have NTFS support? Yes, we do. We've had the old read-only NTFS driver in the kernel for ages. We've got the NTFS Fuse driver in user space, and more recently, we got NTFS 3 from Paragon Software, which offers read-write support. So why do we need another one? Well, the developers of NTFSPLUS claim it offers better performance and more features than NTFS 3. Now, I haven't tested this myself yet, but if you dual boot with Windows or regularly work with NTFS partitions, this could be worth keeping an eye on. Competition in the driver space is usually a good thing. It pushes everyone to improve. All right, let's talk about the elephant in the room. Fedora 43 is officially here, and it's making waves with one very controversial decision. The Fedora Workstation Edition, the main GNOME-based version most people use, has completely removed X11 session support. It's Wayland-only now. No fallback, no option to switch back. If you want to run Fedora Workstation 43, you're running Wayland. Now, before the comment section explodes, let me clarify a few things. First, legacy X11 applications will still work through X-Wayland. That's the compatibility layer that lets X11 apps run on Wayland. So your favorite old applications should still function. Second, this only applies to the Workstation Edition. The KDE Plasma Spin and other flavors still have X11 support where needed. But this is still a big deal. It's Fedora making a statement that Wayland is ready for prime time. And honestly, for most users, it probably is. Wayland has come a long way in the past few years. Multi-monitor support is solid, fractional scaling works, and most of the major pain points have been addressed. That said, there are still edge cases. If you're using NVIDIA proprietary drivers, well, your experience might vary. If you're running specialized software that depends on X11-specific features, you might run into issues. And if you're doing any screen recording or streaming, you'll need to make sure your tools support Wayland. So what else is new in Fedora 43? Well, it ships with Linux kernel 6.17, which brings improved hardware support for modern systems. AMD Ryzen processors get smarter workload distribution through the Hardware Feedback Interface, HFI. Basically, the kernel can now better understand which cores are best suited for which tasks, leading to better performance and efficiency. Intel systems benefit from improved multi-core scheduling, which should make multitasking smoother, and there's support for Intel's IPU7 webcams, which is excellent news if you've got one of the newer Intel laptops. On the desktop side, Fedora 43 comes with GNOME 49. The significant changes here are three new default applications, though Fedora hasn't specified which ones yet. There's a redesigned search interface in Nautilus, which is the file manager. And you now get media controls on the lock screen, so you can pause your music without unlocking your computer. There are also some new HDR-specific wallpapers, which are cool if you've got an HDR display, and multi-touch input support for remote desktop sessions, which is nice for tablet users. Under the hood, Fedora 43 brings RPM 6.0, which is a pretty significant update to the package manager. The big security improvement here is that OpenPGP keys are now identified by their full fingerprints instead of short key IDs. This makes it much harder for attackers to spoof package signatures. RPM 6.0 also adds support for multiple signatures per package and OpenPGP version 6 keys with post-quantum cryptography. If you're on the KDE Plasma spin, you're getting Plasma 6.5.1, which is a bug fix release. It addresses some issues in KWin, which is the window manager. Wayland sessions get improved color management and output handling, while X11 users see fixes for visual rendering problems. In other distribution news, we got SUSE Linux Enterprise Server 16, which comes with the new Agama installer, SC Linux support, and an impressive 16 years of support. That's huge for enterprise users. We also saw the release of Devuan 6.0, which is based on Debian 13 Trixie, but without systemd. For those who prefer alternative init systems, Devuan remains a solid choice. And for the self-hosting crowd, both TrueNAS 25.10 and Unraid 7.2 got major updates with NVMe OF support, ZFS enhancements, and improved web interfaces. All right, this is the news that many people have been waiting for. System76 CEO Carl Richel has officially announced the release date for the Cosmic Desktop Environment, NEPS, PopOS 24.04 LTS, and Cosmic Epoch 1 will be released on December 11th, 2025. Mark your calendars, folks. This has been in development for, over 2 years now? And we're finally going to see the stable release. For those who aren't familiar, Cosmic is an entirely new desktop environment written in Rust. It's being developed by System76, the company behind PopOS. They started this project because they wanted more control over the desktop experience and because they felt that existing desktop environments weren't meeting their needs. Now, I've been testing the beta builds, and I have to say, it's impressive. The performance is solid, the design is clean and modern, and the customization options are extensive. System76 has put a lot of thought into this. The big question is, will it be stable enough for daily use on day one? That remains to be seen. But tying it to an LTS release of PopOS suggests they're confident in its stability. Speaking of desktop environments, KDE Plasma 6.5.1 was released this week. This is a maintenance update that fixes some compatibility issues with older AMD GPUs. There are your reports of problems with the blurred desktop effect on RDNA 1 and RDNA 2 cards. And this update addresses those issues. Plasma 6.5 itself, which came out a couple of weeks ago, was a pretty significant release. It brought a ton of minor improvements to fit and finish. And already, the KDE team is working on Plasma 6.6, which will include a WinVir command for Windows power users. If you don't know what WinVir is, it's a Windows command that shows you your Windows version. It's a small thing, but it shows that KDE is thinking about making the transition from Windows easier. On the application front, we had a bunch of updates this week. Arch's Pacman Package Manager got version 7.1, which brings stronger signature enforcement. Wine 10.18 was released with Vulkan-based OpenGL mapping, which should improve compatibility and performance for Windows games and applications. Ecodi 21.3 introduced enhanced HDR playback and fixes for Blu-ray issues on Linux. If you're running a home theater PC, this is a pleasant update. Shotcut 25.10, the video editor, added text-to-speech and screen recording features. Bottles 52.0 got a stability boost and sandbox support. And LibreOffice 25.2.7 rolled out with 43 bug fixes. There were also updates to DistroBox, Incus, Image, Gitia, Tor Browser, and many other applications. It's been a busy week for open source developers. One interesting development is that the Debian APT Package Manager will integrate Rust code by May 2026. This is part of a broader trend we're seeing across the Linux ecosystem. More and more core components are being rewritten in Rust for better performance and memory safety. Ubuntu already made the controversial move to Rust core utils. Now, Debian is following suit with APT. Let's talk hardware and drivers. This week, AMD made some waves with an announcement about its GPU driver support. They're putting RDNA 1, that's the RX 5000 series, and RDNA 2, the RX 6000 series, into what they're calling maintenance mode. This means these older cards won't receive day zero game optimizations anymore. When a new AAA game comes out, AMD won't be tweaking its driver specifically for these cards. Now, this caused some panic in the community, but AMD quickly clarified the situation. These cards will still receive driver updates. They'll still get day zero game support, meaning they'll work with new games. They're just not going to get the same level of optimization as the newer RDNA 3 and RDNA 4 cards. And here's the critical part for Linux users. This doesn't affect us. The open source AMD drivers for Linux are developed separately and aren't going into maintenance mode. So if you're running an RX 5000 or RX 6000 series card on Linux, you're good to go. This is actually a great example of one of the benefits of open source drivers. The community can continue to improve and optimize these drivers even after the manufacturer has moved on to newer products. On the Intel side, they're preparing a new Linux graphics driver for their Xe3P architecture with DisplayPort 2.1 ALPM support. ALPM stands for Adaptive Link Power Management, and it's a power-saving feature for DisplayPort connections. This is part of Intel's upcoming Crescent Island GPU, which is an inference-optimized card with 160 GB of VRAM. But there's some concerning news from the Intel camp as well. Foronix, one of the most respected sources of Linux hardware news, published an article raising questions about Intel's changing open source strategy. They've noticed a decline in open source contributions from Intel, along with several key Linux developers' departures from the company. Unbelievable. This is worrying because Intel has been one of the biggest supporters of Linux and open source for decades. Their contributions to the kernel, to compiler toolchains, and to hundreds of other projects have been invaluable. If Intel is pulling back from open source, that's a big deal for the entire ecosystem. Now, we don't have all the details yet, and Intel hasn't made any official statements about changing its open source strategy. But it's something worth keeping an eye on. There, in other driver news, some interesting kernel patches were posted this week. One is for a multi-kernel architecture, which would allow multiple independent kernel instances to coexist on the same physical machine. This could let some CPU cores run real-time kernels while others run standard kernels. It's a pretty experimental feature, but it could be helpful for specialized workloads. There, we also saw the second version of cache-aware scheduling patches. These help modern CPUs with multiple cache levels by aggregating tasks that share resources into the same cache domain. Early benchmarks show some impressive performance improvements, especially on AMD EPYC Turin processors. All right, now for my favorite story of the week. Linux has officially hit 3% market share on Steam. According to the October 2025 Steam Hardware Survey, Linux is now at 3.05%. This is the first time we've ever crossed the 3% threshold, and it's a massive milestone for the Linux gaming community. Now, I know what some of you are thinking. It's just 3%. That's still tiny. And you're right, it is small compared to Windows. But context matters here. A few years ago, Linux was barely at 1% on Steam. The fact that we've tripled that number is significant. Second, Proton. Valve's compatibility layer that lets Windows games run on Linux has gotten incredibly good. The vast majority of games now work on Linux with little to no tweaking required. And in many cases, especially with AMD hardware, games run just as well or even better on Linux than on Windows. Third, the overall improvements to the Linux desktop experience, Wayland is maturing. Desktop environments are getting more polished and hardware support is better than ever. It's easier than ever to use Linux as your daily driver. So yeah, 3% might not sound like much, but it represents real progress. And more importantly, it sends a signal to game developers and publishers that Linux is a viable platform worth supporting. Wow! Speaking of SteamOS, version 3.7.8 was released this week with official support for the Lenovo Legion Go S. This is Valve's first time officially supporting a handheld device that isn't the Steam Deck, and it's a big deal. It suggests that Valve is serious about making SteamOS a platform that other manufacturers can use. In other community news, there are some developments worth mentioning. The Free Software Foundation announced the Librophone project, which aims to create an entirely free software operating system for mobile devices. This is an ambitious goal, and it'll be interesting to see how it develops. Redox OS, a Unix-like operating system written entirely in Rust, enables multi-threading by default on x86 systems. Redox is still very much an experimental project, but it's making steady progress. Servo, the Rust-based web layout engine that started as a Mozilla project, released version 0.0.1. This is the first official release under the Linux Foundation Europe, and it's a sign that the project is still alive and making progress. Woof! And Git developers have been discussing the potential release of Git 3.0 by the end of 2026. This would be a significant version bump with some breaking changes, but it would also bring some essential improvements to the version control system that powers most of the open source world. Unfortunately, not all the community news is positive. Ikey Doherty, the founder of Solus Linux, and more recently Aaron OS, has been missing for 6 months. There's been no communication from him, and the Aaron OS project is in limbo. This is concerning, and I hope he's okay. The Ubuntu Unity project is also facing an uncertain future. There haven't been many details released, but it seems like the project might be winding down or changing direction. As I mentioned earlier, there are questions about Intel's commitment to open source. These are all things that the community needs to keep an eye on. All right, that's everything I've got for you this week. It's been a packed one, with some genuinely exciting developments and a few things to be concerned about. So, let me know in the comments. What are you most excited about? Are you planning to upgrade to Fedora 43? Are you going to try out Cosmic when it releases in December? Or are you just happy to see Linux gaming hit that 3% milestone? If you enjoyed this video and want to stay up to date with Linux news, make sure you're subscribed and hit that notification bell. I put out videos like this every week, breaking down what's happening in the Linux world. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Stay curious, keep learning, and keep using open source software.